Here are people who aren't who they say they are. Number 9, Milli Vanilli. Any 80s babies up in here? I know you guys can remember Milli Vanilli, the German R&B duo of Fab Morvan and Rob Pilatus. They won the Grammy for Best New Artist way back in 1990, along with other awards as well. If you don't know, Milli Vanilli was wildly successful and huge in the late 80s and early 90s. They sold millions of records those years, and they appeared to be on their way to becoming legends. They topped Billboard charts and had 6 platinum singles. The first signs of a big lie were brought up by Beth McCarthy Miller, then an executive with MTV. She said that Milli Vanilli's first interview with MTV gave her and her team doubts as to whether they had actually sung on their records, as they both didn't speak English very well. The first public sign that the group was lip-syncing came in July 1989, during a live performance on MTV. As they performed on stage, live in front of an audience, the recording of the song Girl You Know It's True jammed and began to skip, playing the lyrics Girl You Know It's over and over on the speakers. What really brought down the group was when one of the actual singers on the albums revealed that he was one of the 3 real singers for the group, and that Pilatus and Morvan were imposters. Milli Vanilli's Grammy was withdrawn 4 days later. The duo finally had to come clean, and revealed personally that they didn't sing any of the songs that had made them famous. Number 8. Rachel Dolezal. For years, Rachel Dolezal led the life of a black woman. Her friends believed she was a black woman with a passion for African-American issues. She was president of her local NAACP chapter and a university instructor in African-American studies. However, her parents outed who she really was. Estranged from their daughter, her parents came forward in June 2015, exposing the truth. The story quickly became an international sensation. However, the story gets even weirder. 2 months later, Dolezal decided to start another scheme. From August 2015 until November 2017, Dolezal received nearly $8,850 in public assistance from Washington State. Prosecutors charged Dolezal, who legally changed her name in 2016 to Nkechi Amare Diallo, with felonies of theft by welfare fraud, perjury, and falsifying records for public assistance. During the more than 2 years she received public aid, Dolezal reported only one single source of income, $300 per month in gifts from friends. But investigators with the state's Department of Social and Health Services found that she had deposited nearly $84,000 in her bank account during that same period. Let's add tax evasion to pretending to be someone she obviously isn't. Number 7. Rick Ross. When you're in the rap business, street cred is one of the main things that's gonna help you in the business. Or at least it was until the early 2000s, when Ja Rule's career was basically put to rest by 50 Cent. We've gotta hand it to Rick Ross. Don't hate the player, hate the game. He's made a huge career on make-believe. He took his rap name from Freeway Rick Ross, a real-life drug dealer who built an empire in Los Angeles. Ross's real name is actually William Leonard Roberts. In 2008, his credibility took a hit when pictures leaked showing Ross clad in a security officer uniform, working as a correctional officer. He was so adamant on keeping his rep intact that he claimed the picture was Photoshopped, and that someone took his high school pictures and put it on someone else's body. Of course, nobody believed his story, and soon after, details about his salary, the exact dates of his work, and the place of his training were revealed. The internet is undefeated. After everything was out, he still lingered for a few months until basically he had to just admit he actually worked as an officer in the mid-90s. He accepted that it was him in those pictures, but that he was only doing his job. Somehow, some way, Teflon Ricky Ross didn't go the way of Ja Rule, as he's still one of the superstars of rap today. Number 6, Roger Day. In 2009, a man named Roger Day marched at a Remembrance Day parade with a bunch of medals that anyone would be proud of. However, organizers of the parade said they became suspicious of Day's 17 medals. Organizers said no one could have lived long enough to have collected so many medals, Isn't this something that Day should have at least checked when he decided to pull this stunt? Roger Day was found to be a carpenter without a single medal earned. Day had only served 14 months in the army without any tours of duty. In the pictures from the parade, Day was marching along veterans wearing 17 medals on his chest. The medals included the Distinguished Service Order and Military Cross, the highest bravery awards after the Victoria Cross. Day insisted his medals were genuine, but said the official Secrets Act prevented him from giving details. One expert stated he'd be world famous and some sort of a Rambo character if he really were awarded all the medals. Day eventually gave up and confessed to being a fraud. Number 5. Francisco Rendon. Anyone going into Francisco Rendon's dentist office in Chicago might have thought that things looked suspicious. For starters, his office was located between an auto body shop and a scrap metal facility, and not in a standard, you know, office building downtown, for example. His office had two rooms, a waiting room and an examination room. However, that's pretty much where the similarity stopped. When he was performing dental examinations, he asked his patients to sit down on a leather office chair and spit into a garbage can instead of a sink. All this should be warning signs for anyone, no matter how much their tooth hurts. Needless to say, Rendon was only pretending to be a dentist. When police raided his office, they found his office just steps away from a machine used to polish metal called a bone crusher. They also found five people waiting in the room. Rendon claimed to be a licensed dentist from Mexico, but as it turned out, Rendon lacked all the credentials necessary to provide dental care in the U.S. He had no city business license and no U.S. credentials to practice in the country. He was arrested and charged with misdemeanor for delivering medical services without a medical license. Number 4. Gerald Shirtcliffe. When someone decides to live a lie, how long can they go on? Gerald Shirtcliffe supervised the construction of a building in New Zealand back in 1987. However, for the 115 people that passed away who were in the building during an earthquake on February 22, 2011, having Shirtcliffe supervising the construction of the building is the worst thing that ever happened to them. As it turned out, Shirtcliffe stole the identity of a professional engineer and faked an entire life starting in 1970. Shirtcliffe took on the identity of English engineer William Anthony Fisher, someone whom he worked with in South Africa in 1968 and 1969. Shirtcliffe took all of Fisher's identity, including his birthplace, birth date, and his Bachelor of Engineering degree from the University of Sheffield. Because, why not? Shirtcliffe lived in Australia as William Fisher for more than 25 years. Shirtcliffe even used the Fisher's bachelor's degree to get into a master's program in 1971. And in 1972, he used Fisher's name to become a member of the Australian Institute of Engineers. He was awarded a Master of Engineering Science in Highway Engineering in April 1974. Who even knows if he didn't just cheat his entire way through grad school? The real Will Fisher, now retired and living in England, said he had no clue about the theft of his identity. Number 3. Ronald Melly. Is there any profession that's worse to fake than a surgeon? Being a fake surgeon has to take the cake. Pretending to be a pilot means that that person suffers the consequences as well. Cutting someone open having no clue what to do, could there be something worse? A fake doctor in Kenya was finally busted for being a fake surgeon, but only after he managed to perform 9 surgeries on unsuspecting patients. Ronald Melly worked for years at a local hospital in Kenya without anyone noticing that he wasn't a real doctor. He operated on 9 different people, with 8 recovering just fine, while only one person died during surgery. The county health chief officer explained that the patient who died was pregnant, but very critical, noting that the team managed to save the baby. The fake surgeon was revealed after a report from the Ministry of Health was published, listing his qualifications, or really the absolute lack thereof. The report, which came as a surprise to the general public, listed all of the people Melly had operated on. But this wasn't the craziest thing. The Health Committee of Kenya actually backed him up and encouraged the government to train him as an MD because he showed that he really wanted to be a doctor. Okay. Number 2. Bill Nye the Science Guy. If you were a kid in the 90s, then you probably got your periodic dose of science through TV's super famous show, Bill Nye the Science Guy. Known for its quirky humor and rapid-fire MTV-style pacing, the show won critical acclaim and was nominated for 23 Emmy Awards, winning 19 of them. However, surprisingly though, Bill Nye isn't actually a scientist. Yep, just like many scenes in reality TV, the title Bill Nye the Science Guy is really just a facade. You guys know how Bill Nye got his stage name? While performing on a sketch comedy television show in Seattle called Almost Live, through the 1980s, Bill Nye cultivated a science-explaining TV persona. He got his stage name when he corrected another host, John Keister, on his pronunciation of the word gigawatt. And when Keister responded, "Who do you think you are, Bill Nye the Science Guy?" that's when the name stuck. Yeah, I'm sure millennials everywhere are devastated over this, but Bill Nye isn't a science guy, but rather a mechanical engineer, as he received his degree from Cornell and worked at Boeing after school. After his incredible TV success, Nye continued working in the science field, becoming CEO of the Planetary Society and writing several best-selling books on science. The biggest problem is he doesn't have any formal education in any of these areas. Bill Nye never actually graduated with a degree in the sciences. In 2017, a new show premiered on Netflix featuring Bill Nye, called Bill Nye Tackles the World. Let's just say it didn't go over so well. It was weird in the way that he was trying way too hard to resonate with millennials. While he does call himself a science communicator when he gets called out, it's fine when he's doing it for entertainment on a TV show. But he's skating the line when he's somehow being selected to represent real scientists who do real work at commencement speeches and just happily does so without a second thought. Number 1. Brian Williams. Even in this era of fake news, it's a bit unprecedented for reporters to just completely lie. Reporters have been known to spice up their stories a little, or maybe cut and snip segments to push whatever narrative they're trying to push. News is supposed to be the objective, but now things are different. And Brian Williams took it a little too far. Or actually really far, to be honest. Brian Williams was one of the most recognizable news anchors in the US. He captivated audiences nationwide by retelling a story about being a passenger in a military helicopter that was gunned down by ground fire in Iraq. Soon after it aired, Williams' story was criticized by Lance Reynolds, a flight engineer on board one of the three Chinook helicopters that had actually been fired at. Reynolds and other crew members said that they were forced to make an emergency landing, and that Williams' helicopter arrived a half hour to an hour later. Williams hadn't been anywhere near the fallen helicopter. Williams confessed to have made a small mistake on his recollection. Yeah, it's called a blatant lie. Following his little faux pas, he was suspended for 6 months without pay. Here's what's next.